Hi, today I thought I'd show you a better way of working with objects in OpenGL, namely Direct State Access or DSA. So OpenGL was originally developed to be a finite state machine, which in human language means that each type of object present in the API only had one state or slot in which an object could be worked with, meaning that whenever you wanted to do something with an object, you would have to bind it to that state slash slot. But in OpenGL 4.5, DSA was introduced, which allowed us programmers to directly edit or work with an object, removing the need of binding and unbinding things 90% of the time. So first of all, you want to make sure you have OpenGL 4.5 or a newer version working in your project. In my case, since I use GLAD for my OpenGL context, I can check the supported version by looking into my glad.c file. I also use GLFW for the window creation, so I need to make sure I put in the appropriate version when creating the window. Finally, make sure that your shaders have the appropriate version as well. Let's start by taking a look at the most common types of objects in OpenGL, namely buffers. Here you can see an example of some non-DSA buffers and the DSA version of the same thing. The ID creation of both versions is the same except for the names of the functions used. When it comes to how data is put into the vertex and element buffers, you can see that in the DSA version, no binding is required. Binding the VAO is also not required at this stage, the attribute properties being set by the use of an ID. An extra step needs to be taken here though, specifically the binding of the attributes using GL_vertex_array_attribute_binding, where the ID attribute index and binding index, which is usually 0, are plugged in. Also notice that the stride of a vertex is specified in the attribute for the non-DSA function, while with DSA it is specified in another function, GL_vertex_array_vertex_buffer, which takes the ID, binding index, vertex buffer, offset in buffer, and the vertex stride. Finally, the elements buffer can be linked to the VAO using GL_vertex_array_element_buffer. When it comes to drawing using the VAO, we are still required to bind it sadly, but at least there are fewer bindings we have to keep track of overall. Now, for textures, we simply start by creating a texture without having to bind anything like in the non-DSA version. The texture parameters are identical except for the first argument, which is the texture ID rather than the texture type. As for fitting the image data into the texture, you must first use GLTextureStorage2D, specifying the texture ID, number of levels of the texture, the internal format, the width, and the height. Then, using GLTextureSubImage2D, input the ID, level index, X offset, Y offset, width, height, format, data type, and finally the image data itself. And to generate mipmaps, simply use the functional GLGenerateTextureMipmap. For using the texture, we only need to use GLBindTextureUnit rather than activating the texture and binding the unit like in earlier versions of OpenGL. And the last type of object I'll go over is the frame buffer. Just like with the previous objects, you simply have to create it using GLCreateFrameBuffers, there being no need for binding while initializing it. To attach a texture to it, you make use of the GLNamedFrameBufferTexture function, which takes the ID of the frame buffer, the attachment point, the ID of the texture, and the mipmap level of the texture. It should be noted that just like with VAOs, frame buffers still need to be binded when used. I've left a link in the description to a GitHub repo where you can find an example project which makes use of all the DSA objects used in this video. So that was it for DSA. Overall, it should reduce the amount of bugs you encounter due to accidentally modifying binding objects, and from what I've heard, it should also increase performance due to less GPU calls, though you might want to profile it for your specific use case. Unless you're making a program for an old machine that doesn't support OpenGL 4.5+, I see no reason not to use this new addition from the Kronos group. That was it for this tutorial. If you've got any questions, feel free to drop a comment below or join my Discord server in the description. A big thank you to all my Patreons who support the making of these videos. All relevant links are down in the description. Bye!